All right, so, you know, we're used to seeing on TV or used to looking at a radar image and just our eyes being drawn to the reds and the pinks, you know, 60, 70 dBZ plus, and thinking, whoa, that's where our monster hailstones are. Is the largest hail always located with the highest reflectivity? Well, I'll show you an example that no, it's not always the case. And as we discussed in the previous examples or previous modules, you can get some of those really big hailstones to fall out kind of on the edge of where you have your highest reflectivity. So this is going to give you the clues and the tips that when you're looking at radar images, you can tell your friend, for instance, as your friend is saying, whoa, 70 dBZ, there's some monster hailstones there. And maybe there are, but maybe you also need to be looking where dBZ is perhaps only 30 to 40 dBZ. So going forward, we take one last look or one more look at differential reflectivity again, trying to stress these ideas, what they mean, what we're looking at with it. Again, it's telling us, you know, a comparison of how much power we've received in the horizontal to the vertical. So things that are spherical, perhaps a hailstone, for instance, is going to have ZDR close to 0 dB. And correlation coefficient can tell us, again, how pure our radar sample is, or perhaps if we have giant hailstones. Again, with some of those weird shapes, lobes, spikes on them, they're getting really big. That will drive correlation coefficient downward to 0.8, 0.7 even. So we have our large hail recipe, a simple large hail recipe. We're looking at a cell similar to one of the previous schematics. Here's our updraft. We have some small and large raindrops in our updraft area, and this is where we're going to grow that hailstone by introducing a lot of liquid water to our growing ice particle, our growing hailstone. So away our hailstone goes, like magic, we can watch it grow. So it sort of is moving around, rotating through our updraft. If you have a rotating updraft, that helps in terms of the hail growth. That's a talk for another time, but it takes these nice long trajectories through our updraft, and so has lots of time to collect lots of liquid water and go bigger and bigger and bigger at these sub-freezing temperatures. And then we send our radar signal through it, and we'll imagine a few more larger hailstones there, again with some of those spikes and lobes on them. So if we imagine looking around 5,000 feet plus above the freezing level, we see an area that has ZDR typically close to 0 dB. You can even see some slightly negative values. Some of it has to do with the scattering that's going on. We won't delve deep into the theory behind electromagnetic scattering, but you can even see ZDR that's slightly negative if you start to get some really large hailstones. And you see correlation coefficient frequently get reduced to 0.9 or even lower if you start to see some of these really big hailstones growing, or they start to collect a lot of water in this wet growth type regime within an updraft. So I mentioned around 5,000 feet plus, we're dealing with around negative 10 degrees Celsius, negative 15, even getting above that, negative 20. These really cold temperatures, this is where we want to focus to look at where our hail is growing in an updraft. So we're going to move to our example. This was an example from last year in Grand Forks, North Dakota. On the left is reflectivity, on the right is differential reflectivity. We see some pretty high values of ZDR, perhaps as a ZDR arc, actually, if you were to go back to the previous module. But what we see here is a nice, well-defined thunderstorm, perhaps even a supercell. But what we want to do is look up. We want to see where the hail is growing, because, of course, we want to predict it before it gets down to the surface and is already damaging things on the ground. We want to get that warning out. So if we look at 6.5 degrees, we're tilted way up top. We want to look at, again, areas where our hailstones are growing. So negative 10 degrees Celsius, negative 15, negative 20, even colder temperatures than that. So many thousands of feet above the freezing level. So you want to have a good idea, of course, of how your thermal profile looks on a day before you even delve into radar data. But if we imagine this is our area that we're interested in, on the left we see what looks like a bounded weak echo region on reflectivity. So that tells you right there something about the updraft, pretty strong updraft. And we look in ZDR, nothing stands out too much, but we'll highlight this area, again, where we have our bounded weak echo region. And right there, we have some actually relatively lower values of ZDR, close to zero or even less than zero. And this is, again, around 15 to 20,000 feet above ground level. We're looking way up in the storm. If we switch to correlation coefficient, though, we see values of correlation coefficient that start to get as low as 0.8, even 0.7. It's not so low that we're worried about dealing with non-meteorological scatters, we're pretty sure. And again, we're dealing with an area within reflectivity that's pretty high, so we're likely dealing with meteorological scatters here. But wow, that's low correlation coefficient. That's that large hail growth that's ongoing. If you spot the signature right about where you're expecting your updraft to be located at these really cold temperatures aloft, we see as hailstones grow larger and larger and larger and they get some of these interesting shapes to them, you drive correlation coefficient downward. And so that tells us right here that we have probably some pretty big hailstones that are going aloft. So we go back to our hail recipe again, and we'll let our hailstone go as it swirls around the updraft and gains more and more mass, collecting liquid water. And then remember the idea of size sorting in the previous module, in the previous presentation. That hailstone starts to get to a size that's so big that despite the fact it's maybe right on the edge of the updraft, it can't be sent that far downstream. It can't be advected that far downstream. It might just tumble out of the edge of the updraft, where the upward motion of the updraft starts to get weak enough that the hailstone falls. So now we'll scan it closer to the ground, maybe at that typical 0.5 degree base scan, and we're looking closer to the ground. Similarly to our area aloft, we can expect ZDR, maybe around 0 dB, perhaps even slightly negative. And correlation coefficient, once again, those lower values, 0.9, perhaps even lower than that. The cool thing here, though, is reflectivity doesn't have to be that high, as we mentioned. It can be less than 50 dBZ, and we'll see an example of that right here. Perhaps you have just a few really big hailstones that are falling to the ground, so you don't have that much reflectivity, but those are pretty big hailstones, so we want to know that they're there. So looking at our example, now going a little bit forward in time, here we have, or at least this, we're looking at the same image at 0.5 degrees, that low-level scan as we were initially with this storm, actually. But now we will go forward in time and look at the change here that happens. We'll highlight the area for you. We see this lower reflectivity right here that exists, nothing particularly high, but it's right there in that inflow region of the storm, right on the edge of higher reflectivity. And it lines up with ZDR, if you see right in there as I'm circling it, that's all close to 0 dB. And it was a rapid low-level appearance of it. ZDR, again, slightly negative, right around 0 dB. Reflectivity, 20, 30, 40 dBZ, not that high. Let's look at correlation coefficient real fast. Well, it's not super low correlation coefficient, so it's meteorological. We're looking at values maybe 0.8, 0.85, some upwards of about 0.9, but we see this area of reduced correlation coefficient values less than 0.9. So we start to add the puzzle pieces together. That seems like a, you know, pretty large hail signature that I'm interested in. And we got a report only 3 minutes later, right in this area, of 2.5-inch hailstone, or a hailstone 2.5 inches in diameter, right there that matches up our timing pretty nicely, just a few minutes later, in this area of relatively low reflectivity, 30 to 40 dBZ. And so those are those big hailstones. And it's not to say you can't get big hailstones falling deeper within the downdraft, but you can get a few, you know, in reflectivity that's not quite as high. And we can use Dual-Pol to tell us that that's going on. Now, this is where we're going to start to introduce specific differential phase just a little bit to get an idea of how you can use it as well in tandem with reflectivity. So remember our values and our degrees per kilometer, our higher values telling your horizontal wave is lagging more behind your vertical wave. There's a lot of liquid water, a lot of melting hail. Whereas closer to 0 degrees per kilometer, zero if you can imagine, we're not seeing that lag. Our horizontal and vertical waves are tracking with each other nicely. But a lot of melting hail gives you these high values. How can we use that? So we look back at our cell, and this was the area we were interested in for that really large hail that we saw. But we're going to highlight an area where we have our high reflectivity. And notice something. These specific differential phase, or KDP for short values, are over 4 degrees per kilometer back here in this area of really high reflectivity. So really high KDP tells us there's a lot of liquid water, perhaps even a lot of melting hail. So what that tells us when we look back at reflectivity now is there's a lot of contribution to reflectivity that's coming from just a lot of melting hail. Not necessarily gigantic dry hailstones, but just a lot of melting hail that's really reflective. And so what we can gauge from this is that our highest reflectivity maybe isn't necessarily indicative of the size of the hailstones there. It's just we have a lot of melting hail. And in closer, in reality, is where we're interested in that really large hail, because we've seen the signatures there in terms of low ZDR and reduced correlation coefficient, that maybe that's where some of our biggest hailstones are falling. So again, you can put those puzzle pieces together to say, well, why is my reflectivity really high here? Is it because I have big hailstones, or maybe is it just there's a lot of liquid water and melting hail, and perhaps the hailstones aren't necessarily that big? That's pretty cool to be able to add those pieces together. So you can add more detail to reflectivity using the Dual-Pol variables. Some combination of differential reflectivity, correlation coefficient, and even KDP, as you just saw, can help you identify where the largest hail is likely falling within a thunderstorm. And sometimes we can see that the largest hailstones might fall where reflectivity isn't even that high. It's relatively low, perhaps as low as 30 or 20 or 30 dBZ. We've seen numerous examples out there where these monster supercell thunderstorms right on the edge of that reflectivity gradient in the inflow region is where you're getting some really big hailstones. And with that, we'll wrap up our large hail signature presentation.